Yeah, Chatty's good. Chatty's excellent.
So, I have a feeling you have a skill set there.
I like to chat.
So,
Hi.
hi. Usually I say hi. You beat me to it. It's good. You've gone from being that person whose face everybody knows to a brand name in a couple of years, no? Does it feel that way?
I guess in some way it feels that way. I mean, there are people now that come up to me and go, "Are you Margo Martindale?" I go, "Wow, it's nice to know that you know my name." Yeah, for
You've been
years
doing
it
this for a
was, "I
long
know
time.
you." Yeah, I've been doing it for a long time. And it's, for many years people have come up to me, but you don't know my name. Aren't you in, or were you, or, do I know you from, the court downtown, or are you a teacher at the school? But now it's, I guess at least they know where they know me from.
So they now come up to you and ask for apple pie, or
And say, I'm not going to take any drinks from you. Yes, exactly.
how long ago did you start? Were you a kid actor? Were you a
No, I
teenage
well, you
actor?
know, I was a kid actor because I was playing in my backyard, and I produced plays in my backyard. And then I was a cheerleader in high school, and somebody asked me to come and audition for the musical because they thought I was loud, and I got the part, and I was hooked. 16 years old and hooked.
So were you in, what city were you in? Where were you?
City. I
What
was in Jacksonville, Texas. Very small town
a
in East
town.
Texas. Yeah.
And so how did you emerge from Jacksonville, Texas to, I don't know, Dallas? Was it, where did you
Well,
go
no,
first?
actually, I went from Jacksonville, Texas to University of Michigan. So in my little bitty hometown was the oldest junior college east of the Mississippi, Lon Morris College. And it happened to have the most famous acting teacher in the state of Texas, Zula Pearson. So all the kids from Houston came to Jacksonville and Dallas, and even some out-of-state kids came to go to school where this teacher taught. It was a little Methodist school, a two-year school, and she was extraordinary. And it was an extraordinary, incredible drama department. And I went from high school to there. I happened to know her for growing up in Jacksonville all along. And then I got 22 scholarships to school, to other schools, and I chose University of Michigan because it had Helen Hayes and Jimmy Stewart on the cover of the program. I knew who they were.
So did you get did you get what you would need for all these other years in that first couple years of studying?
I
Is that
didn't need to really go to school anymore. I got 40 hours of theater before I went to the University of Michigan, and so I had to take graduate courses. To
I'm sorry, there's something wrong with the mic. If I
Okay.
could say that last question, maybe we could go back to the
Okay,
intro.
okay.
It was
Okay.
so
As natural conversation goes, you always go
Yes,
back to the last
exactly. What
question
was it?
and take again. I was just asking whether you got from your first couple years of learning
Well,
acting.
you know what? I learned what I could, and what I did was I did 8 or 9 plays there, and I learned what upstage and downstage was, and then they coached me for these auditions for University Resident Theater Association to get a scholarships, and I got an offer scholarship offer from every school there except one.
Who were the stupid ones? Tell us.
It was Stevens College.
Oh, they're crying now.
It was because it was an all-girls school, so they didn't really need any more girls.
So you went to Michigan.
I went to the University of Michigan.
Was that a complete culture shock?
Complete culture shock. I didn't even know where we were going. My one of my dear friends from Lon Morris got a scholarship there too, and we went together and hooked up a U-Haul and drove, and we were complete idiots. Complete idiots.
And so did it turn out well, or was it kind of just the whole spent 2 years trying to figure out which way was up?
It turned out well in that I did another gajillion plays, and it was in, I would say it took me about a year to kind of make my way in the theater department to where I was recognized as, you know, good. I know my first audition there, Christine Lottie beat me out of a part that I'd worked all summer on, and I just couldn't believe it.
Well, at least you're a good competition.
She's good, yeah.
Better her than, you know,
yeah, exactly.
So was it from Michigan to
Michigan to Harvard. I went to, I got a job at the Loeb Drama Center, what it was then, with doing Three Penny Opera with Christopher Reeve and Jonathan Frakes. And I, from Harvard, I met some people, and then I moved to New York. And I didn't even know I was going to New York, but that's what happened.
So what was all that, I mean, did you feel like you were kind of just going through things and you just kind of move forward as you went, or did
kind of that. I didn't really have a plan. My husband always says he had a plan to go to New York, and I had no plan. I just ended up in New York, and it seemed to be right.
So you worked a lot?
I worked a little.
Worked a little.
When I first got there, yeah. I worked in a telecommunications place with a bunch of actors, and then I got an equity card doing The Revenge of the Space Pandas, or Binky Rudich and His Two-Speed Clock by David Mamet. Mm. Oh, David Mamet kind of co-directed it. And then that was about 1975. Then 1977, I got another job. And then 1979, I started to work. Mm.
And then it's kind of never stopped since then.
No, it did. It stopped. It stopped. It stopped. I did a lot of plays, and then I did a lot of hit plays. And mm-hmm. I got invited to come to the Actors Theater of Louisville, which many. I met Chris Cooper there. Chris mm-hmm. and I were good friends. Bates there. Holly Hunter there. My dear friend Susan Kingsley, who died there. But and great playwrights, Beth Henley and Jim McClure mm-hmm. and. There were just one great playwright, John Pielmeyer, great playwrights. So we then got a play, and I traveled all over the world with them. And then I got a play that we did in Louisville that we brought to New York in 82 mm-hmm. to the Manhattan Theater Club. And I
Miss Firecracker?
No, it was before that. It was called Talking With.
Okay.
And I was picked as one of the new stars off Broadway, along with four other people in my cast, mm-hmm. and John Pielmeyer and Gary Sinise and mm-hmm. And John Malkovich.
Little name here and there.
It was, and then I went back to Louisville, and then I came and did the Mr. Firecracker contest, mm-hmm. and Holly Hunter became a star from that, and that was 84, and then 86. I replaced Kathy Bates in Curse of the Starving Class. 87, I originated the role of Truvy in Steel Magnolias, and everybody in Hollywood came, and I got my first movies.
And they figured it out.
About 88 or 89, yeah.
So it was getting in the movies like a big objective? Was it something?
I never even thought about it.
You were happy doing theater.
I was happy, but I did. I remember thinking, sitting on the campus of Harvard, with the sunlight hitting me, sitting under a tree and hitting me a certain way, and I think I could do movies, because I felt like I understood what it was.
Just because you,
just
got
because
it from
the way
them?
The light hit me, because I knew that God or the cameraman who was watching me could tell what I was thinking.
Wow. So you started doing movies, and was that what you were hoping that would be, or thinking that would be?
It was fabulous. It was just wonderful. I love doing movies.
You love the kind of acting you do?
I love the kind of acting in movies, yeah. Love it.
As much as theater, or differently than theater?
Differently.
Just different energy.
Very differently. Differently in that the theater is a community experience. Mm-hmm. It's a shared experience with the audience, and movies is very personal.
But you like that?
I love it. I love it. Yeah.
So you were going along for a long time? We saw your face quite a bit. We knew you.
Yeah,
from all
but
kinds
you didn't
of
know who I was, did you?
I actually did, ironically. But I think my wife saw you somewhere actually recently, a few years ago, and she asked, and she's like, "I know this woman." She kind of kept letting, maybe it was in this movie, and like I figured it out who you were, and told her your name because.
Oh my goodness! Really?
Well, you're terrific. You've been terrific for a long time.
Oh,
so
thank you so much. Well, it was. I thought I got a break when I got Lorenzo's oil. Now I got Lorenzo's oil from somebody coming to see me in a play at the Manhattan Theater Club. George Miller.
Yeah.
George Miller and his partner Nick, who wrote The Boy from Oz, wrote The Boy from Oz, but had something to do with that. Australian. Okay. He may not be with us anymore, but
yeah.
They came to see me like three times in that play and then cast me in the movie.
And was the experience, so now you're working with George Miller.
Uh-huh.
Got a big rep. And is one of my favorite people, actually, oddly. He had kind of a tough rep at the time.
I just loved him.
He's just very warm.
Oh, I just thought he was delicious and wonderful and incredibly hard and an extreme perfectionist.
And that's a tough movie. That's a tough movie. Tough show to be, hard show
but
to be
I
on.
Thought it was a beautiful movie.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was very operatic.
But hard for people. I mean, I love that movie.
It was hard for people. I think it was really hard for anybody who had male children.
Yeah.
Really hard, but really spectacular. And at the time that it came out, I was doing The Firm, mm-hmm. and Tom Cruise had gone home and at Christmas and seen it and came back, and I was his secretary. And he got down on his knees and he said, "My secretary was so wonderful." I try to remind him of that when I saw him a couple of years ago. He didn't remember me, but that's okay.
So you felt like you were on the magic carpet at that point?
And then I did think I was, and I was mistaken.
Just didn't?
Well, I thought it would do. I mean, I actually got lovely notices in that movie, and I thought it would change things. And, you know, it didn't change anything. It just was another addition.
So you've added more and more pieces.
I added more and more pieces. And it wasn't until, I don't know, I guess really and truly, till Justified that it really changed things. I thought it had changed before, but you know, there are about steps about this big, and then you go back down to the bottom step again.
Mm. So was it having the hardware in your hands that was the moment that changed it, or were they?
I think that might have helped, yeah. It also was the part.
Yeah.
It was a gigantic movie part. No?
I'm so sorry.
So.
We were into.
I think we had you holding the Emmy up over your
head. Oh, right. That's it. That's right.
Smiling. And you got it for Justified.
Uh-huh.
And that was the kind of game changer?
I think that it was because it was a. It felt like a movie, but it was very long. Mm-hmm. 10 episodes. And so it was a. It was great to play actually a sort of a leading part in a television show for
and
one,
had you
one season.
That, had you played that tough before?
Never. Well, I did Million Dollar Baby, but it wasn't as tough as this woman.
No.
That woman was not smart.
Yeah.
This woman was really smart.
Well, Million Dollar Baby, she was really like, it was such a brief moment, and it was so intense. It was almost like a different place.
It's a different place, and also because she was ignorant, and Mags Bennett was sharp as a tack.
Yes, she was. Her son wasn't so much, but
no, that he was a village idiot. But that's okay.
But he's a great actor.
He's really wonderful.
So at that point, people started seeing you, and then we saw The Americans.
The Americans, yes.
It's fun to be the cloak and dagger.
Yes, really. That was fun. I'm going back to do it. I'm very happy. Actually, I got my scripts right before I came here.
So you're ready to, you can kind of go from, you have enough room in your sitcom schedule to.
I don't really, but I'm doing it.
You'll find a way.
I'm doing it, yeah.
Now
they're making it really easy for me, The Americans, yeah.
So had you seen August Osage County on stage before you? Twice.
Twice or three times, yeah. I loved it.
Pretty remarkable movie.
So I thought Rondi Reed, who played the part that I played, was so perfect that I thought, I don't need to do this on stage, but I do want to do the movie of it. So I did sort of put that out there as soon as I saw the play.
And did that just come back to you in the universe, or did you?
It came back to me. It came back to me in the form of, you have an audition for August Osage County.
So what are they looking for, or they're auditioning you? I mean, you have such a long length of song about him work.
I think that they really wanted to see all of it. I think that the audition, I think most, certainly not all of the people, but quite a few of us auditioned. And I auditioned twice.
Did they know that, did you know at that point that Chris was your opposite number in the movie?
I didn't know it.
So that was kind of just fate.
It was just
kind of lucky.
Delicious.
Because the two of you really are kind of, you steal the movie at times.
And well, it's we're old friends.
So was it is it a tough movie with all those people kind of showing up? And
it just felt like a regular movie. Isn't that silly? It did. It was just so, it was exciting, extremely exciting. And I knew Meryl, I knew Chris, and that's the only, those are the only two people I knew.
You mean every celebrity in Hollywood doesn't know every other celebrity? That's not.
I guess not.
You don't get together for family reunions every year?
I went to the Hollywood Film Awards last week or week before last, and it was like, and I thought, boy, we're in Hollywood. It was very Hollywood. I mean, it is a, it was, I did feel slightly lonely.
But you're gathering numbers as you go along.
It's interesting.
So did you have the script before you did your audition, or did you just have sides? Or
oh, how yeah. Did I have the script? Yeah, I believe I had the script. And I had the sides, and I actually prepared as if I was doing it as a play.
And so, did you notice the differences between Tracy's play and Tracy's screenplay?
Well, there's a difference,
yeah.
But it's very in keeping with the play, and it's as poetic as the play. Mm-hmm. And I think he's an extraordinary writer. It's so poetic. Mm. And then you get there, and we do a read-through, and there's Sam Shepard sitting there, who I've done his plays, and it's reminiscent of Shepard too, and I mean he's a whole different feeling, but it's you know, boy, did he have great appreciation for it. I can tell you that.
Well, it's hard to even imagine that somebody has a darker soul, but Tracy, I think, as a screenwriter, is another notch on the darkness scale.
Pretty dark. Hey, and he's acting all over the place now.
It's kind of thrilling, actually.
Yeah, it is. Thrilling. I didn't get to see him in Virginia Woolf. I'm sorry.
I feel it much the same way. Yeah. The two of them, because Amy Morton was in that also, Amy, who was on Broadway with the show.
And I got to do a movie with her, like, year before last or something.
So do you have a method? Is there a way you get into a character? Because you make it look so effortless.
I try to really learn it. I try to get it inside my body so that it doesn't feel like there's any technique to it. But I am a technician.
So you're very conscious of everything you're doing?
I'm not conscious of it, no. But, I mean, I have the framework. It's just that you have to... Well, that's not true. I do it all different kinds of ways. That particular part, because Maddie Faye she speaks what she thinks, so that she is not she's not introspective at all. Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit of a different muscle for me. But, you know, I mean, I think I'm more introspective. I know I'm more introspective than that character is. So it was a character for me to play it. Even though somebody say, "Oh, you were that's just you. It's not just me at all." Because she's speaking on the word, she says exactly what she is, and she's not, and everything she does is kind of right. There's really no regret.
Yeah,
it's an interesting person.
Well, she's a little reflective of the youngest sister in the show also.
Well, that's interesting.
In that she just doesn't, though I think she's, yeah. I mean, she's obviously older and more stable in some ways. She has that relationship to lean on with her husband. And that's fascinating to watch throughout the movie and the show as well.
Wow.
There's a lot going on.
There's a lot going on.
For a movie where, you know, for a story where it's a lot of big fun moments or big dark moments and big tough moments, there's also just constant subtext playing back and forth. It was
deliciously fun.
So is the set fun in a movie like that? Does everybody kind of lean back after?
I don't think everybody leans back. I think that everybody was there to do it, and everybody was so excited about the whole process and being to be, and we really became a family. Mm. I mean, we ate together. We watched the presidential campaign, all the debates together. Mm. We watched Hurricane Sandy as we sat in Oklahoma together, and you know, we're so wondering what had happened. It was a real family.
Was that by design by John, or was that just
more designed by? Yeah, he got us together every Sunday night. We all had a place to eat together on Sunday nights because in Bartlesville, a lot of things closed, so John made certain that we had a place to go to be together on Sunday night. Mm-hmm. But also, mostly we gathered at Merrill's house.
So what is it, I mean, what is your relationship with a director at this point? You've...
With John Wells? Or
well, you, in general first, I mean, you obviously have a strong sense of where you're going with something when you're going
there. Well, I tell you, it just depends on who the director is. I mean, Alexander Payne sort of understood. I did a movie, Paris Je T'aime, and he wrote it for me. And I think he sort of understood what I could do. So he directed me like he directed me like, that's okay. It's just a lawnmower.
just to keep things interesting.
He directed me like he was directing a silent film actress. So it was really... But that's a whole different, that's all psychological and getting in my head. Just different people, different ways. Robert Benton knows me really well, so.
Is there a way you prefer to be directed, or is it just a relationship that changes each time?
I guess it changes each time, and who I have more of a simpatico with.
So how was it with John?
What?
How was it with John Wells?
John was a different kind of a director. I liked him and I respected him way more. He gave me something that I sort of didn't want to do it a certain way, but in the end, he was right and I was wrong.
Unusual?
Huh?
Unusual?
No, I think it's not unusual. Probably, it's just that it was something that I wanted to be more indulgent. And my character's not an indulgent character.
Yeah. So how do you know where you are I don't know what's happening behind us now. There's apparently lawnmowers going on behind us as well.
What?
Apparently there's stuff going on behind us as well.
Oh.
Do you know, as you're going through the process in a picture like this, how it's going and where your character is and... You know, when you're halfway through production, you go, okay, I've found it, I've hit it, and I'm there, or?
I didn't on that.
Did you know by the time it was over?
What?
Did you know by the time it was over, or did you have to wait till you saw it?
No, I didn't. I had to wait to see it.
And when did you see it in Toronto the first time, or you see it
No, I
that?
Didn't. I wasn't able to go to Toronto because of my show. So I saw it in New York in June, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And I was blown away by the whole thing.
And do you have any problem watching it?
Now there's an airplane.
It's God's will.
No.
It's just looking over. It's going over.
It's a pretty day though, isn't it?
It is a lovely day, but you know, we can actually hear you because of the mic, so it works out okay.
Okay, good.
So when you see a movie like this or anything you're in, are you okay watching yourself? Is that an issue? Are you distracted by it?
I'm totally okay watching myself. I'm usually pleasantly surprised.
She's good.
No, I mean, sometimes I go, oh, I didn't think, you know, and I'm pleasantly surprised. And sometimes I see that the thing that I would like to be able to do sometimes is I think I could go farther or further. Because my sense of reality is pretty solid, mm-hmm. so that I can go broader in certain things that I think I can.
So is there a movie or anything where that you've done where you can tell us where you've wish you had gone much further? Or
there are some, but I couldn't tell you right now. I don't even remember what movies I've been in. I know the last two. That's what I can tell you. I know the last two.
So did the Millers come into your life after you finished August, or was it?
The Millers came in after I finished August. Yes, after I finished August, and I was doing The Americans. Mm-hmm. And I came out here because Jake Kasdan called me and asked me to do, because I'd done Walk Hard, the Dewey Cox story with him. Mm-hmm. And he called and asked me if I'd come out and play Jake Johnson's mother in New Girl. Mm-hmm. And I said, I don't want to. Just because I didn't want to have to get on a plane and go and... And he said, oh, come on, I'll make it worth your while. So I said, okay. So I came out here, and I had a lot of people wanted to see me for new shows. Mm-hmm. Now, I wanted to stay on The Americans, but The Americans wasn't picked up, and I didn't have a contract. So... Mm-hmm. I didn't know what was going to happen with my character,
right.
since I was dead on FX for Max Bennett. I didn't know really, because my character could so easily have been
right.
gone. So I went for pilots and got the Millers, and now I'm doing a comedy, and I find it challenging because I don't think I'm quite good yet, but I think I can get good.
You don't think you're quite good yet? Because you're... Because you're so internally, you're just waiting for that moment where you
I'm just trying to wait for me to click with this person.
Huh.
And right now, I'm still playing a part, and I'm ready to be together with that part.
And is having a partner like Bo in it, which for me, it feels like pairing.
Pretty great.
Does that make it easier? Does that...
Makes it... I tell you what makes it easier. That's the greatest group of people ever. That, that cast and the whole... group of people is the loveliest, most easy, wonderful. It's a great job, and I'm going to get really good at it.
So you'll know when you're really good at it.
I will.
It's not gonna be when people tell you.
I think I will. I might have gotten fairly good this last week.
And now you're spending a lot of time in Los Angeles because of it.
Yes,
which is not your homeland.
It's not. No.
Did you ever live in Los Angeles, or have you just missed that altogether?
I did The Riches out here for FX, and I did Justified.
And but you've never moved here. You've
never moved here,
and no urge to do so, I guess.
No urge. What?
No urge to do so anytime soon.
No, and I'm here now.
Yeah, but I mean, you're an East Coaster. You like being an East Coaster.
I'm an East Coaster. Yeah, I've lived on the same block since 1978.
Mm. And do you love now wandering from thing to thing as you squeeze the Americans in
I guess I do. I'm very happy to go back and do the Americans. Drama is easier for me, even though I started in comedy. It's just I want to really get good at this because it's a challenge.
And so when you have your summer hiatus or whatever period it's going to be.
Yeah, my agent asked me, said, I'm going to get you this. I said, just hold on. I don't know that I want to do anything.
So you may want a vacation at some point.
I may want a vacation.
You don't want to just work back to back to back to back. You like to breathe.
I like to breathe. I like to be with my family. Yeah.
But is this the best moment of all of it? Or is this...
It's another wonderful moment. It's another wonderful moment, and I can remember some, and I remembered some in August, and it was reminiscent of a one that I remembered from sitting in a director's chair with my name on it, probably didn't have my name on it, with Susan Sarandon and Lorenzo Zoil, it was the fall in Pittsburgh, and thinking, this is incredible. I want to be able to remember and take this in because this is such a fabulous time. Mm-hmm. And I had that feeling on August, sitting on the back porch of the house, looking out over the Oklahoma landscape, thinking, wow, this is incredible. It's the same kind of feeling, yeah.
Is it that same feeling when you're on the stage and you're doing a scene? On the stage of August, on the set of Osage County.
Oh, that's what I'm saying, yes.
Yeah.
That was on the set.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So it wasn't as you were having your Sunday night dinner and family?
Oh, no, I'm talking about, this is in the house of Violet, my sister.
And are there things where you feel now like you can just go and do them and you have it and they're not really much of a challenge for you?
There are things that I don't, it would be not fun to repeat.
So that's not, you want to be pushed.
I want to be pushed. Or I want to get a whole lot of money for not being pushed.
I think both ways sound really, really good.
It's true.
Thank you. Are we at 25 or are we at 30? I don't even know where we are. This has been so on and off that we still have a few minutes left.
So go.
So what else is going on? Now that the lawnmowers have gone.
That's very quiet.
It's very quiet out here. So you just was acting when you were a kid and you were doing shows in your backyard and all of that? Is this what you kind of...
I tell you when it felt just like the backyard was doing Justified.
How so?
It was Justified. I don't even know what that... That was like flying to me. Mags Bennett was like everything I ever was. And I could just be whatever I wanted to be. And there was nobody could tell me how to play that because that was my own gig.
And you knew when you were doing it that it was that.
I knew that I could just go as dark and masculine and calculating and anything that I wanted. I could go anywhere with that part and be right.
And is that in the writing, or is that in the directing, or is that
in the writing? It's in the writing. It's in the directing. It's mostly in the writing.
Mm-hmm.
And it was also a part that I just happened to be perfect for.
Mm.
All my insanity.
Do you feel insane? You seem so not insane at all.
I'm slightly insane.
Because you seem like the person everybody would want to have over for dinner on Thanksgiving
night. I am that too. But I am a little bit. I'm phobic.
Ah, so you have that
I have that
to be odd about.
Yeah, to be odd about. Yeah.
But you seem incredibly grounded and.
I'm grounded. I'm scared of the dark.
Mm. And is this? Do you think your family?
Do I think
brought that to you? Are you a product of your youth or?
I was scared as a little kid. I was afraid of tornadoes. I was scared of lightning. I rode horses and I was crippled and I was a lot of things. And I came from a family of hunters and athletes. And I had a fabulous mother.
Mm.
I don't know what I am. I'm just.
Well, it's an interesting thing because you're one of those people that, you know, a few of you come along who everybody connects with in this kind of very...
Well, isn't that nice?
It's a fascinating thing, because it's not a magic trick. And even just talking to you before we were on camera, or when we've had to turn off the camera a couple times, there's just a kind of like an ease and comfort and...
And you know, I can tell you that when I was in need of money and I would get a residual check...
Mm-hmm.
And my husband always worked. We always had. Look, we always were fine.
Mm-hmm.
But there were times where it was, you know, yeah. I needed to cash it.
Mm-hmm.
So you go to the checks cash place so that you could get instant cash. And lining up with all the people in the checks cash place to get your check cashed was a very religious experience for me.
Mm.
That's who I felt. That I felt like, that's kind of who I feel like.
And still do.
And like one of those people in line, yeah, to get their money. Yeah, I do.
Even when you're shooting your sitcom, or particularly these days.
Yeah, I kind of feel that way too. Yeah.
And does the frou-frou of all of it interest you at all?
Not much at all.
Red carpet is not
what does interest me a little bit is a new car. I'm a little bit into a car. I'm driving a Hyundai rental right now. Mm-hmm. We own a 12-year-old Infiniti, and I'm really looking at those leather interiors of cars, and that's fun.
So you just want to be able to live your life comfortably.
Yes.
And do your work.
That's right.
And that makes you the happiest person
absolutely.
In the world.
Absolutely. It's wonderful. I'm living a blessed life that I'm very grateful for.
Well, I think you have a lot of people rooting for you because there's a sense that you've worked so hard and long to earn it, and now you're getting sowing the seeds.
It's been good. And you know what? It's probably at the right time. I don't know that if I'd done this earlier, it wouldn't have been the same way.
Hmm.
You know, the appreciation and whatever I would have done with it. I don't know that I would have grown like I've grown.
So is there something besides comedy that scares you at this point?
Well, comedy doesn't scare me. It's just, I get to watch myself every week and I go, well, I just hate that. Uh-oh, my tits look too big. Uh-oh, that's not good. I mean, that's really, there are a lot of things that I'm looking at. It's not just the acting. It's the body. A lot of times it's like, oh dear, don't ever turn that way again.
Well, that's always the great thing about season two of a show is you see there are three characters who have lost 50 pounds in the off season.
And you're like, so true.
They watch the season.
And watch me, I'll be one of them. Very funny.
So is there anything else? Though? Have you done a musical? Have you done?
I would like to do a musical. I've been offered several. I did one off Broadway, but I really just did the backup singing on it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very musical, and I'm not a great singer, but I can sing.
Well, many of the musicals we've seen lately, not really an issue for people, apparently.
But, you know, when do you have time to do that?
Well,
and that's a chunk of time.
I have a feeling you're going to be stuck in the Millers for 8 or 9 years.
Stuck. Just 8 or 9 years and I'll be 70. Oh, let's see what we're going to do now.
Well, it's the prime of life if you're Meryl Streep or Margo Martindale. It's, you know.
Meryl Streep. Wow. And she can cook.
You can cook?
I can cook, but I can't host like she does. She's unbelievable.
She's the Martha Stewart of Academy Award winners.
She is unbelievable. She can do anything.
That's kind of frustrating after a while.
It is kind of frustrating. Well, I just have this open kitchen. I'm going to just make these pork chops like this and just talking and chatting and making it look effortless. I would love to be able to do that.
Well, it's coming in 8 or 9 years.
Now, there's something I could work on. I'm a terrible hostess.
How is that possible?
Because I'm too nervous. Because I want everybody to have a really good time.
But people probably have a really good
and
time.
And I think probably it'd be better if I had people wandering around serving drinks and stuff. Instead of, can I get it for you? Can I what? You know, I'm not that person.
When your season six contract for the Millers.
I'll hire some caterers.
You'll get some caterers.
That's a good idea.
I think we figured it all out. I feel very, much very better
good.
Now.
Very good.